Good evening, everyone, and welcome. Thank you very much for joining us today. My name is Chris McElwee. I work at the Department of State as a Foreign Service Officer, and I'm going to be moderating the questions and answers today. But because there are so many of you, we are not using the chat function, we're using the Q&A. So as you think of questions for our panelists today, please enter them and we'll try to get to as many as we can. We have about an hour. So I'd like to just start it off with David Kennedy, who will introduce himself and our other panelists.
Thank you very much, Chris, and welcome everybody to this webinar. We're very excited to be with you this evening. So this webinar, and we're excited to be careers at the U.S. Department of State. In particular, I'd like to thank the National Society of High School Scholars for this opportunity and for their continued partnership on these programs. My name is David Kennedy. I'm a Foreign Service Officer, and I've been in the service for about 30 years. So I'm working in Washington now as the Director of the Office of Citizen Exchanges in the Bureau of Educational and Cultural Affairs. In my office that I oversee, we oversee a wide range of exchange programs for American and international participants of all ages. All ages, but we do start with high school and we go all the way up through sort of, you know, mid-40s and 50s. These include fully funded study abroad opportunities for high school students, which I encourage you to check out at exchanges.state.gov/high school. The Department of State is the country's oldest cabinet department. It is responsible for U.S. foreign policy and international affairs and comprises foreign service, civil service, locally employed, overseas, generally that's referred to at embassies and consulates, and contract staff, working in nearly 40 bureaus and over 250 embassies and consulates in approximately 180 countries around the world. I've served in a wide range of posts, and I'm not going to get into it too much detail, but maybe we can touch on these things later. But as a Foreign Service Officer, I'm currently serving here in Washington, and I've served in many posts overseas, from India to Russia to Ethiopia to Geneva. So a wide range of places I've served in. And we have a wealth of talent on our panel. Joining me today are Allison Dower, an academic exchange specialist working in the Office of Academic Programs, and Stephanie Jensby, a strategic media analyst in the Office of Global Public Affairs. We will each tell you a little bit about ourselves and our individual paths leading to the department. But first, let me ask each of them to introduce themselves and pass it over to Allison. Allison, could you just briefly introduce yourself?
Absolutely. Thanks, David. And thanks, everybody, for the invitation to be here today. My name is Allison Dower, and I work, as David said, in the Office of Global Educational Programs. I currently work on the Humphrey Fellowship Program, and I am a civil servant at the U.S. Department of State. I'll stop there for now.
Fantastic. Thank you. And then and over to you, Stephanie. Please introduce and yourself and the work you're currently doing and have been doing. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Good evening, everyone. I am also a Foreign Service Officer like David, and I am currently working in the Bureau of Global Public Affairs as a Public Affairs Officer and Strategic Media Analyst. I have also served in South America, North Africa, and Western Europe over 18 years now. And I'll leave it at that and hope to be able to answer some of your questions and motivate you to apply to work with State. Thank you, David.
Thank you very much, Stephanie. And now all of you here tonight, I hope everybody's starting to put in some questions. I can see some questions coming in, but as we get the questions and have a chance to look at them, and all of us will, let me go back to our panelists and ask a question. Maybe I can ask myself first a little bit, how do we got to where we are? And I'll say it briefly, and everybody has a chance to think about it, because you're all thinking about your futures as well. Well, where I got, for me in the Foreign Service, I'll be absolutely honest, probably I was just reflecting on that. My first real connection to it was in high school was a Russian literature class, and I took excellent Russian literature in high school, and I had a fantastic teacher who introduced me to that, which opened up a whole world to me in the area of Russian history, Russian studies, which I have, as you can see, I have a little bit of gray beard, and I go back a little bit. And so in the 80s, the Soviet Union was the principal issue for us in foreign policy. There are many other issues, but that was probably the one in the Cold War that dominated. So I gravitated towards that. And the opportunities were largely in the diplomatic world. We didn't have open, there wasn't much business. And so I moved towards the diplomatic world and became a diplomat. It took time, it took effort. I ended up getting a master's degree and I did different other things. And in the process, and I'll finish it on one thing, because as you look at the world of diplomacy, and then we'll pass it over to Allison and Stephanie, if that's a career, there are many different opportunities in the world of diplomacy, and we all represent them. But I joined something at the day working on cultural exhibits in the former Soviet Union. And so I went there as a Russian language specialist after graduate school. And I learned about the area of public diplomacy, which I then subsequently spent my career doing, and public diplomacy we can get into in detail if people are interested, but it's areas that we practice. And it's ultimately largely the practice of engaging non-government audiences, from media to academics, to think tanks, to students, to non-government organizations. So I'll stop there. My path did start largely at the time where I think many of you are. And I had a really fantastic teacher that opened up my eyes to real opportunities. So Allison, let me ask you to share a little bit your experience on how you ended up choosing your career and where you are today. Over to you, please.
Excellent. Thanks, David. Yeah, happy to share. For me, the path began actually in college. I went to a four-year university, and I had the chance to study abroad while I was in college. And I remember thinking to myself, wow, everybody should have to do this, because if everyone had to do it, we would all be a little bit more understanding about people who are different than us. And that sort of, that really interested me in the field of international education, which is closely tied to the field of public diplomacy, of course, as you mentioned, David. When I was in graduate school, I applied for an internship to work in the Bureau of Educational and Cultural Affairs at the US Department of State, because I was pointed in that direction by a career counselor while I was sitting in her office. And so I applied for the internship and I got the internship. And while I was doing my internship, I tried to speak to as many people as possible. I tried to let them know how interested I was in the field and in what the State Department was doing in this field. And as a result of those conversations, there wasn't separately an opportunity for a pathways internship, which is a way to get into the civil service as a graduate or undergraduate student. And I applied for that position, and I was told about it by someone who I mentioned, who I had been speaking with about my interest in the field. And because of that, I applied for and given a position at the Bureau of Educational and Cultural Affairs, a paid internship. I was able to finish my graduate studies and eventually was offered a full-time position at the State Department. And I've been here now for 9 years, working in three different jobs over the time. One quick note I'll make is that the civil service is different than the foreign service. The civil service, you are stateside the whole time, so you don't change posts, you don't go overseas, except for, of course, occasional work-related travel overseas. But it's slightly different than the Foreign Service, so I wanted to make sure I said that. And that's it for me. I'm happy to answer any questions that anybody has. Thanks.
Thanks, Allison. That's a really good example of the different paths and the different types of positions and careers the State Department offers. Stephanie, how did you end up where you are now? What key moments helped determine your choice of your career?
Well, prior to joining State, I accumulated a lot of experience in three different fields. Directly after undergraduate, I worked in the publishing arena. And then I decided to go to graduate school, where I focused on the administration of international programs. That sort of took a turn towards healthcare programs. And I had a couple of practicums, one in Bolivia and then one in rural North Carolina, providing public health care programs for the folks in Bolivia. There were young teenage mothers who had been abandoned by their families. And in the United States, I was helping migrant and seasonal farm workers. But the whole aspect of it was around international program management. After that, I sort of segued into promoting international travel and educational experiences. So a quick summation, I had prior work experience that involved some travel before joining State. But I like to think of that experience as representing everything I was interested in: cross-cultural communication, use of foreign language, and a focus on public service. And it was after 9/11 that I decided to join the State Department to put some of my skill set into practice. And I'll leave it at that.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. Now, we really look, I'm looking, we have some great questions coming in, and I think we're all going to take a chance at going through them. And so we will kind of self-moderate and take turns picking questions to answer. So maybe I'll start, and then we'll, after myself, Allison, and then Stephanie, and we'll keep going around. So if you in the chat room or in the Q&A room, if you have a question for somebody in particular, do indicate that maybe out front. But I did want to highlight, there was a question, I think it's a good one, from Drake Leary. I'll start out with a question that, what educational major should an aspiring Foreign Service officer go for? And I think that's a great question for people like you at this time to think about. And I reflect back on myself and in looking back over the people I've worked with, myself and the different careers and the types of people who I've encountered in the State Department, in the Foreign Service. And I would say principally, there's no specific major that prepares you right for the Foreign Service. Probably, I can speak for the Foreign Service, probably for the civil service too. I think in the Foreign Service, I'll talk about that more specifically because that's what I did. You ultimately, as you probably know, you take an exam to enter, and you don't even have to have a college degree. You have to be 18, and I think it's 18, and you have to pass an exam, a written exam, and then there are some oral exams, and then you get in. It's a process. I won't go into too much detail, but anybody, any American citizen can apply for it. And in my career, I've seen a wide range of excellent people. You may think that I should do international relations or I should do history, and that may help to a certain extent, but ultimately, some of the unusually excellent Foreign Service officers that bring tremendous diversity to the Foreign Service will be a biochemistry major or an environmental scientist or a person who studied literature and poetry. It's a wide range. I think in the end, it's a commitment. The skills needed in the Foreign Service are strong people skills, are strong communication skills, analytical skills, management skills. And what the Foreign Service looks for is a tremendous diversity of people to apply in geography, in range, in age, in sex, in ethnic, in all sorts of issues. And so I think that's incredibly important. And so back to the question, there isn't one. And you might think there are some traditional ones. And so I think as you go, if you're interested in the Foreign Service, pursue your education and continue to look at it. And you can, and it's always an opportunity to do it at whatever stage of life you want. And you can, and there's no age at all. You can do it up to a certain point, up to the retirement age. So I'm going to stop there and pass it over to Allison. And then she can hand the baton on and we'll go around. So thank you very much for that question.
Great, thanks, David. I'm gonna answer Luca's question, which is, what does the civil service and in turn a civil service officer do? Thanks for this great question. The civil service is sort of broadly speaking, it is generally government officials who work here in the United States. It is people within the Commerce Department, people within the Department of Education, but also, of course, at the State Department. And civil service members are all across the country working in various governmental departments. I would say in turn, what does a civil service officer do? It depends on their position that they're in. For example, what I do every day is I help to manage a grant that manages one of our large exchange programs that's funded by the US Department of State. That means that I'm in touch with our grantee partner about managing the overall fellowship program that I run. There are civil servants who are lawyers, who are teachers, educators, who work in public affairs. There are many different ways to talk about what a civil service officer does, and it depends on where they're working. I will take a shot at having answered that question. And if there's anything that Stephanie or David would like to add, I would welcome their additions. Thanks.
Stephanie, I think you could add to that or pick a question to respond to.
Sure, I'll pick a question from an anonymous attendee. When diplomats serve overseas in foreign countries, do they have to be fluent in the language of the country, or are there professional interpreters who work for the Department of State? So with my experience, the answer is no. You do not have to have the language of the country in which you're serving. I have experience with that. I served in Casablanca, Morocco. I'm not an Arabic speaker nor a French speaker. And yes, we do have professionals who work with us, our locally employed staff members who are fluent in English as well as their mother tongues. And in the case of Morocco, I work with Foreign Service nationals who were trilingual. So it was quite impressive. Of course, if you do have the language of the country you're serving in, it does help you in your personal life. The Foreign Service does offer language training, and many of the jobs do require that the officer has a fluency level of 3 in speaking and reading in the language. So for example, for my consular tour in Peru, I studied Spanish and passed the exam and was able to work on the consular line in the language of the host country. So it all depends. I do understand that when you are testing and trying to enter the Foreign Service, you may receive a few extra points based on your fluency in what's considered a hard language. For example, Chinese, Japanese, Russian, Korean, I believe there are a few more, but I'll just stop there.
Great, thank you very much. I just wanted to make sure I wasn't on mute. I'll come back to me. I'm going to combine a couple of questions that are somewhat similar. One from an anonymous attendee that Stephanie touched on a bit, which is, what do you do? What exactly does a Foreign Service officer do? But also, what is the role of the Department of State? And I think these are important questions. What is the role? Because we're talking about careers at the Department of State. The Department of State, as I'd said in my introduction, is the country's oldest cabinet department. Is responsible for US foreign policy and international affairs. So essentially the Department of State is the branch of the executive, is the part of the executive branch that reports to the president and executes and implements the president's foreign policy. The president designates or nominates, which is then approved by the Senate, a Secretary of State who carries out a policy of the president. So that is the ultimate role of one thing, of carrying out the policy, and the policy affects many, many areas. So as we heard, it could be from cultural, educational exchange to political issues to economic conditions. I can touch on that a little bit as well, but essentially it implements the policy of the president. And these policies, of course, ultimately change a little bit for, I mean, change by the presidency, but if you look over the course of the history of the United States, there is a considerable consistency because of a country like the United States does have consistent interests and values that are captured and supported by all the American people. Policies do change, whether it's trade or things of that sort, but of course, broadly. So that's one thing broad. That is what the Department of State does. There's a tremendous range of issues, but it's focused on foreign audiences principally and engaging. Now, I will say a couple of things about what foreign service, it says foreign officers, but I think foreign service officers do. And I would say, again, it's the role of the Department of State. I've worked overseas, foreign service officers primarily, you know, for most of their career work in embassies and consulates overseas, carrying out that policy of the president and the secretary of state in the country assigned. And they can be in different areas, but I will highlight one thing in particular, probably the number one priority for American officers overseas and embassies is to represent and protect and support Americans and American interests. And that is one important way through that is through our consular office. And there's a whole, in the Foreign Service, you have different areas you work, but the consular area is an incredibly important area because they are an area that actually have and support American citizens overseas. It's something called American Citizen Services. Whenever there is a crisis or anything happens, incredibly top priority is for embassies to support Americans. That was very, very true during the COVID pandemic. I was in India at the time, and we spent probably 2 months after the outbreak, perhaps longer, all sort of 24/7 repatriating Americans back to the United States. And chartering flights, getting this, arranging, it was an incredibly important work, but that we dropped everything to support American citizens. And that was one example of a crisis, but it could be you lost your passport and you need a passport when you're stuck wherever you are traveling. So, and the other thing I will close, I don't want to talk to you because there's a range of careers. We've talked a little bit about what we do in public diplomacy. Some of us do that. You could be a political officer when you analyze the politics of a country or an economic officer doing similar work. And things of that sort. But I will end by saying in the Foreign Service, the State Department is most known, but there are other areas of the Foreign Service too. The Department of Agriculture has a Foreign Service. The Department of Commerce has a Foreign Service. They're smaller. You apply to them separately, but they are all part of the Foreign Service serving at embassies abroad and representing the United States. And there are others, but I will say the last probably significant foreign agency, but it's gotten complicated. There's so many nowadays, is the U.S. Agency for International Development, which oversees America's development programs and humanitarian assistance overseas. So there's a range of issues of roles that foreign service officers do, but they're all ultimately executing and implementing the policy of the president. So I will stop there and we'll pass it over to Allison again, please. Over to Allison.
Great, thanks, David. I'm gonna answer another anonymous question. Can you easily go between the civil service to the foreign service and vice versa? This is a great question. I know colleagues who have done this, either converting from foreign service to civil service or the other way around. I can't say that I've ever heard of someone going from one to the other to the other, back to the other. Usually it's just one way. There are definitely ways to do this. In fact, I think there have been avenues to making this a bit easier for folks to do, especially when there are colleagues who have kids who need to be sort of, who need special attention or need certain health situations where they need to be in the United States for care. I know for a fact that this has been done. And I think, from what I understand, it's fairly easy at this point. And I will stop there.
Okay. Yeah, Stephanie.
Sorry, I'll pick up the next question from an anonymous attendee. Is working in the State Department the same as working in an embassy overseas, or are they separate? We meaning stateside and overseas, both are dedicated to implementing the president's foreign policy goals. It's done differently, of course. One of the biggest differences that I experience from being overseas or being in Washington, D.C., is the community that one can build. When you are at an embassy, there's a greater opportunity to build a community amongst all the other officers and locally employed staff members. Here in the US, you're at home and everyone, you know, leaves work at 6 o'clock and goes their separate ways. So while you may become friends and enjoy a lot of lunches, at least in my experience, there weren't a lot of opportunities to engage after hours or on the weekends. So that's one of the differences that I've experienced, really building good friendships and ties that have stayed with me as I've transferred from post to post. I'll stop there.
Great, thank you. I guess it's back to me and then we'll keep going around. There was a question from an anonymous attendee since it's seems somewhat addressed to me. I will take it on, saying David Kennedy mentioned how he works in public diplomacy, e.g. non-governmental organizations, think tanks, community leaders, et cetera. What exactly does that work entail? And what department does he work for in that? Now that's a good question. And give me a chance. I will certainly talk about public diplomacy. But when you join the State Department, the Foreign Service, if you go through the process and you take a written exam and then there's an oral exam and other small steps. But you enter into a cone, and in the Foreign Service, or it's called a cone. There are certain areas of general focus. One would be the political, one would be economic, one would be consular. One is management, one is public diplomacy. This is in the State Department. I did mention there are some other foreign affairs agencies. So I chose public diplomacy. And so that means principally I work in that area in my career in the Foreign Service. And what that entails is essentially what the United States, I think, was a leader in this. And it started years ago, of course. It's recognizing the importance of non-government audiences overseas or anywhere. They recognize their importance in influencing opinion about the United States and in influencing, therefore, possibly policies for the United States, but also engaging. You can influence in for certain ways, and you can engage non-government members of foreign countries to become partners, or over time, you know, just developing good relationships of trust, mutual understanding, and others. So at an embassy overseas, say a political officer would principally be working with the Ministry of Foreign Affairs or some other political parties and be focused on that. A public diplomacy officer has a wider range of areas that he or she will work in. And it breaks into two generally, I don't wanna be too complicated, but two areas of public diplomacy officers spend their career on broadly. Both of them are outside, are dealing with audiences and people and people outside of governments. One is media, is handling all the media operations for an embassy and the US government in that country. the a public diplomacy officer would often be the spokesperson for the embassy. In today's world, it's gotten much more demanding with the tremendous rise of social media. So overseeing all the social media, the media relations, and supporting, of course, the ambassador overseas in executing the president's policy and explaining the president's policy through the media. So that's one important area that is part of public diplomacy. The other broad area of public diplomacy is what you alluded to and I talked about mostly is engaging important audiences that affect that country's democratic or public organizations. And that ranges from universities, because that's an important area for shaping opinion and dealing with opinion leaders, and also meeting next generation leaders such as you, speaking to students, working in that area, working on exchanges, inviting qualified students to come to the United States on exchanges. With think tanks, because think tanks are writing about policy and they're affecting public opinion. So engaging with think tanks, with community leaders, because they are active in their organization. So it's looking for members of that country's society who are influential players or who could be, that we want to engage with, that we think would be in the interest of the United States government to have as a friend, a partner, or to explain American policy too. And so it's incredibly diverse and it's incredibly rewarding. I've enjoyed it because I think it's personally the best part of the Foreign Service, because you deal with an incredible range of people offering opportunities for them to engage with the American people. So I'll stop there. If there's more questions on different things on that, please. But over to you now, Allison, for your next question.
Great, thanks. I'm gonna take this one, which says, what was day-to-day life like as an intern? I think that one's for me. So I'm happy to answer it. I think the coolest thing I got to do was I worked on one project on a US and Iraq bilateral higher education conference, which we hosted in Washington, DC. And I got to work with a number of players across the State Department. It's a large organization. And I got to meet a number of folks working in different parts of the State Department. Some were focused on higher education and our bilateral relationship with Iraq, and others were focused specifically on the Near East, the Middle East, and the relationships that we have in the region, which was really interesting. I got to meet a lot of new people and to work on something that was very demanding and exciting at the same time. I would say the day-to-day was a lot more meetings and email, and I did get to work on several briefings for our Deputy Assistant Secretary. I got to take the first draft and see what the clearance process was like. The clearance process is essentially everybody above you gets to make edits to your draft, which is great. I mean, you get to learn, the way to do memos and the way to speak like you work at the State Department. So it was exciting. And I would say I had a really good time working during my internship. So I encourage everybody to apply for an internship at the State Department for sure. Stephanie, over to you.
You're the first person I've ever heard say the clearance process is exciting. So I'm going to take two questions, one from Cassandra Hernandez and one from Adam. So Cassandra asks, what college majors would best prepare someone for a career in the Foreign Service? And Adam would like to know what jobs are best suited for those with an education degree. I think we've all talked about this a little bit. There isn't one major that will best prepare you. I majored in anthropology, and at the graduate level, I focused on intercultural management. But as David said, we have chemists, we have English majors. It's a wide variety. What I'd like to offer in addition is, with your college degree and as you're in school, try to get experience in public speaking, build up your interpersonal skills, build up your writing skills, and build up your ability to take direction. A lot of what we do in the Department of State is we help others do their jobs. So you have to learn that balance between helping someone do their job and then trying to do the job because you think you can do a better job at it. And then moving on to Adam, what jobs are best suited for those with an education degree? Just wanted to say there are two diplomatic tracks within the U.S. Foreign Service. Someone can become either a Foreign Service officer, which involves advocating for the U.S. and its citizens, or a Foreign Service specialist. A Foreign Service specialist provides critical logistical support for diplomatic operations. One thing that comes to mind with someone with an education degree is perhaps being a regional English language officer within the public diplomacy field. You would specialize in promoting education and educational programs and learning English throughout your career as a specialist. I'll stop there.
Thank you. That's great. Thanks for adding on. Incredibly important being a communication and speaking, but also taking direction. That's an important thing. And those are some people have raised questions about that. I mean, of course, you only need to you just apply for the Foreign Service, but to succeed, I mean, work internships, professional experience, getting out there really helps a lot. Let me take a couple of questions, and there are a couple of ones. It's an interesting one. What is it from Kari Seals? It's, you know, sort of about living abroad and the Foreign Service. Is what is it like to live abroad, and do you get homesick? How often can you come back to the U.S.? How is housing and other expenses handled abroad if you also own a house in the United States? Well, that's a great question. I would say, the Foreign Service, the Foreign Service is ultimately a bit of a lifestyle choice, and you commit to living overseas. And so when you're assigned overseas, you can be overseas for quite a while. Often you would do two, maybe three assignments of 2 or 3 years each. And so you could have positions overseas that take you from 6 to 8 years. Could be less, sometimes it could be more, and then you would rotate back and maybe do a tour in Washington in the Department of State. Now, when you're overseas, the embassy will find the housing for you and provides you housing and takes care of that for you. So that is a benefit. You do get free housing when you're overseas. When you're in, and that's part of the assignment there. If you have a house in the United States, as part of the question, that's something you just have to manage yourself. Most people would rent it out when they're overseas. Some people don't have a house when they're overseas, and then come back and rent when they're in Washington. There are different ways of doing it, but ultimately you're on your own when you're in the United States to find housing and take care of that. If you're a Foreign Service officer, if you're a civil service officer too, but overseas that's taken care of. Now I will say a quick point about living overseas too, about, you know, said, you know, what is it like to live abroad? You get homesick and things of that sort. And I've certainly been in the business for quite a while and seen a lot of changes over the course of my career, particularly with technology. Of course, I started my career in the late 80s, actually. I joined the Foreign Service in 1990, so quite a bit of time ago, and that was certainly before the internet and before Amazon, before all these things. Now in the Foreign Service, so you got the internet, you can talk to people all the time, and so you do feel incredibly close, and that is tremendous. And actually in flying and moving around the world, and certainly pre-COVID got easier, Now we'll see how things go. It's gotten a little bit more difficult, and that is a challenge because you are over, that is a fact of the Foreign Service. Things like that do happen. Pandemics don't happen too often, but events can happen that can restrict some travel. But over generally, there's excellent communication and of that sort. And you are in an embassy community that's quite supportive. Some can be quite small. You can be in a country with a very small embassy, and so a very small American community, or you can be in a place like New Delhi, where I was just at, which has got a very large American community with a large American school. And of course, you're in a large city of New Delhi, but you do have a large community. So I think there's a lot to do to be active, and you certainly miss family members, that is true, but with communication today, that has been mitigated to a certain extent. So it is a lifestyle choice, and you have to think about it. And it has many, many rewards, but like every choice, there are some things that are maybe more challenging or like not as good as others. You're a little far from your family and so forth at certain times. So I will stop on that one, but that's a good question, because any choice of a Foreign Service or a career does have important personal and personal impact on your lives. So thank you very much for that question. Now back over to you, Allison, please.
Great, thanks. I'm going to answer Giovanna's question, and I would be curious what Stephanie and David would have to add to my answer. The question is, what would you recommend students in high school do now to prepare for a career with the State Department? And I think this is a great question. I wish I knew what I wanted to do when I was in high school. I think it's great that you do, so just congratulations on that. I would say, if possible, connect potentially with the diplomat in residence that's closest to you. This is a program where senior Foreign Service officers are positioned throughout the U.S., the United States, and they perform a function of diplomat in residence. They are there, and you could potentially reach out to somebody in their office to learn a bit more about what they do. You could also look into various university programs where you could study international affairs. I would say think about where you would like to do an internship while you're in college. That is really an important part, I think, of I think that because it was my experience, to get an internship, and then I was able to continue on. So I would say do that. I would also say, if possible, get some experience overseas. I think it helps to provide a bit of perspective. And also, if you're able to learn a foreign language, that always helps too. Those are my tips. I would say too, one more thing, become comfortable advocating for yourself. I know that this is a bit difficult, and it gets easier as you get older, but don't be afraid to share your accomplishments and the things that you're good at, and to brag a little bit about yourself. I think this can be difficult, but the more you do it, if you spend any time in DC, you'll learn how to do it and to get comfortable with it. So I'll stop there for now. Thanks.
I would also agree, if at all possible, to get some experience overseas. There are scholarship programs that will take you overseas, and you will travel with adults, and you will have structured activities, and you may have the possibility of living with the host family. Of course, we're thinking post-COVID, but I would just echo what Allison said here to have that experience of how you would fare abroad. You learn a lot about yourself in that particular situation. I'm going to answer a question from Megan Lee. What does the process look like of getting assigned a post abroad? Do you ever get to choose? I like to refer to this process, it's called the bidding process for Foreign Service officers, as your parents giving you the choice of a vegetable. You're going to eat a vegetable, but you get a choice. So by that, the vegetables are the posts that are open and seeking new officers rotating in. And you have to do your research. And as Allison said, advocate for yourself. Why would this assignment be a good fit for you? But also, why are you a good fit for this assignment? And for your first two tours, you go through this process and you have a dedicated officer who's working along with you. You present your choice, your choices, and then you get assigned where you get assigned. So, you know, you have your plate of vegetables, but you don't always get the one that you want. That happens for the first two tours. You are directed. At your third tour, you have to lobby for yourself. You are doing the research. You are reaching out to the incumbent in the position. You are reaching out to your lateral colleagues, people you've perhaps supervised during your first two tours, and also your supervisors for references. And you advocate very hard, you interview, and the luck of the draw, you perhaps you get your top choice, perhaps you don't. I have only received my top choice, I think, twice over the last six tours. But at the end of the day, it all works out. And not to be too philosophical, but I ended up where I needed to end up. There's always lessons to learn. And you always fare better than you think in a post that you didn't think you wanted to go to. So maybe David could add to that.
Well, that's a good question. I mean, I mean a good response, and I'm not sure if I can add too much to that because I really agree with your answer. And I think you don't know what's going to come out. And you know, I just think, you know, more in a separate life experience, every disappointment, every challenge, every obstacle, every good thing has a positive outcome, I think. And you can look at different things, and I think there are many opportunities to make choices or that will influence the path you take in life. And I would embrace them, because doing the best you can at any moment will always help you on the next stage. And you never know where it's going to happen. I mean, within the Foreign Service, I've been able to choose some of my posts, not all of them, just like Stephanie, but sometimes something will come open unexpectedly with a unusual, you'd never thought would be there, and you just happen to be right there at that moment, and you can take care of that opportunity. So I think it's important to be prepared, be open-minded, and embrace opportunity and do the best you can, as I think both of my fellow panelists have talked about, in terms of internships and experiences and just embracing them, and because you can help put yourself in that position. Speaking of put yourself, I'm going to take a couple of questions and combine a couple. Again, we've talked about languages a bit. And one question from Christian Oliver is, I would assume learning a foreign language is incredibly beneficial, but it is entirely necessary. And also, as to serving in another country, how long would you serve abroad? And another one about somebody anonymous, for students who were earned a seal of biliteracy, would they be more competitive? Now, and then there was another question earlier about what opportunities for high school students. And I just want to highlight a couple of things, and it's partly repeating things, but learning a foreign language prior to the Foreign Service can be beneficial, but it is not necessary. It can be beneficial because, as I think it was Stephanie put it, for certain languages, not only, but certain critical languages, if you have a fluency level in them, that can give you a step up, not a guarantee, but with an extra couple of points, for so to speak, in the application process, because yes, we are in the State Department looking for people who can speak hard critical languages, and because that is important overseas when you're working in a country that speaks that language, be it China, be it Russia, be it Korea, be it, you know, countries of that sort, India having Hindi, for example. Now, I will mention, so that's a couple of points there, but if you don't have a language, you certainly get into the Foreign Service, because the Foreign Service will teach you the language. We have something called the Foreign Service Institute. So if you're assigned to China and you don't speak Chinese, they build in a process to learn the language. And they actually give you 2 years of study for certain languages, including Chinese. And so you achieve a level of spoken and written and reading Chinese Mandarin, which is enough for you to be a professional in that country. Obviously you improve. So that's very important. Similar for Russian, you can do it for Hindi, for many, many languages, very small languages too. So that's really important. And I did want to, I think that was maybe there was one other thing I was going to say. I lost my train of thought on that, going off on the languages, but I think it is very important to do. Oh yeah, the last thing I wanted to say that, and many of you may know this, but in the office that I work, and many of you, we do offer opportunities for high school students to study critical language. It is called the National Security Language Initiative, which offers academic study in languages such as 8 critical languages. If I can name them, I'd probably be very good. Russian, Chinese, Arabic, Korean, Hindi, and I will probably, there are a couple of others, maybe others, yeah, I will work it up and look it up, but there are opportunities to go study overseas in those languages and then go on that path, paid for by the United States government if you're qualified. So languages are very important, but not essential. But I mean, to get into the Foreign Service, but once in the Foreign Service, you have it. I, for example, speak Russian and French quite well, and a little bit of Hindi. Not too much Hindi, but I did study Urdu and Hindi for a while, so I'm functional in it. So anyways, that's it. Thank you very much. And I'll pass it over to Allison again, please.
Thanks, David. I'm going to take 2 questions. One I've seen a couple of times, and it's, does the State Department have opportunities for lawyers? I will say I'm not a lawyer, but I do know people who are lawyers who work at the department. There are people, we have an entire legal office within the State Department, and they look at a variety of different issues, both sort of on the management and administration side, and also legally and sort of politically, and making sure that, you know, everything that we're deciding and doing is legal. I think it's certainly not a requirement, but there are lawyers in the Foreign Service, there are lawyers in the civil service who aren't necessarily practicing law as part of their work. So I would say absolutely, there are positions for lawyers all across the State Department. And I would say the second question I'd like to answer is about the most joyful aspect of the civil service. What keeps you doing what you do? I would say for me, I work in public diplomacy. I think we all work in public diplomacy. It's the people that you get to work with, and not necessarily your colleagues, but the individuals who are participating in exchange programs, the foreign citizens who are here in the United States or who are overseas, if you're in the Foreign Service, the individuals who are really quite similar to us and who all want mostly the same things as we do. It's that sort of interaction with people who are different and yet very similar to us. That's what keeps it interesting for me. I run a fellowship program for international citizens who come to the United States, and I just got to see a number of them in Washington, D.C. a few weeks ago, and that was really a highlight after 2 years of almost two years of mostly virtual work. So I would say that's absolutely the best part and very joyful. So thanks.
Okay, I'll take a question from an anonymous attendee. One of the things that drew me to this career was how rewarding it could be. What is one life-changing experience that you went through while on the job, or one of your most proudest / significant projects that impacted the life of others? I would say working in consular affairs at our U.S. Embassy in Lima. Not only was it one of my favorite tours, it was one of my favorite tours because I felt that we were making a direct impact, not only on the lives of the Peruvian citizens who were seeking visas to travel to the United States or seeking visas to move to the United States, but we also helped American citizens who found themselves in need while abroad. And one of the most significant experiences I had, sorry to say it's a little sad, but while working, rotating through the American Citizen Services, really being able to help Americans back in the US process through the death of a loved one overseas. It's mission critical work. It's very upsetting to you on a personal level, but just knowing that I was able to help American citizens understand the process, help them repatriate bodies back home or get property that was left back to them was very impactful, as well as on the positive side, being able to verify create a consular record of birth for a new American citizen. Those were the fun things. You know, you get to say, hey, this is a new American citizen when a child is born to Americans overseas. So for me, working in consular affairs, specifically in the American Citizen Services, provided the most positive, rewarding experience.
Great. Thank you. I know, great example. And it's so important, our work supporting Americans overseas. And that's a one example that's incredibly important to individual and members of individual Americans and families. So we're running short on time. I think maybe if we go through and try to take one more question each. But I want to highlight, try to do two a little bit. So what does the State Department today need most from new applicants? What qualities are important in Foreign Service officers? And then there was another one about military service and skills and relating to the State Department. But I'm going to try to do quickly on both. But the first one from Darren, excellent question. I would say probably one of the top priorities. We've talked about, you know, there's no degree or something like that. It's good to be a good communication, you be a manager, this and that. But I think most important, what the State Department and Secretary Blinken has made a top priority, and certainly President Biden has too, is having the Foreign Service represent the diversity of the American people. It hasn't always done that. And traditionally it was a bunch of white men doing it, to be honest. But now a priority in the Foreign Service, and it has been for a while, but certainly in this is making for the full diversity, whether it's gender, ethnic, race, religious, physical diversity across the board. And I think that's very important. And I think that and that brings a real richness. And I've seen that change over my career. And I think it brings a real tremendous more richness to our ability to represent America to foreign audiences. And so that's what I would highlight that. So I think, and that is an important area. And I just quickly say on military service, I'm not sure if I grasp a question, and it says, are there still State Department skill areas inside? We work very closely with the military overseas, and I think there are military officials at embassies generally there is a whole career there. It's a tremendous career in the military, and we have the utmost respect with the military and work very closely with them. With military, there's a sort of a triangle: State Department, diplomacy, military, and development. And so there, and as a military officer at any time, you could join the State Department if you want to take the Foreign Service exam. Skills, they're slightly different, but the military has a very mission-oriented approach, and the State Department has other skills of developing more analysis and support and managing relations and policies, you know, slightly maybe a longer term focus in countries. I don't want to say that too much, but they're different. They're very complementary types of skills that are both incredibly important to the United States abroad and representing the United States. So thank you for those questions. Over to you, Allison.
Great, thanks. I will take a question about presenting yourself. How do you, any advice on presenting yourself for internships and exchange programs? I would say absolutely be authentic. Make sure that you are telling a story that is true to you. And I would say too, and this comes from my experience getting clearances, run any essays or, you know, paragraphs of application by somebody else who you trust and who knows you well. I would say that applications are hard and it's hard to make an impact, to make yourself feel heard in an application. But I would definitely take the chance when you're doing a cover letter or any sort of application to be authentic and to, again, don't be afraid to advocate for yourself and to brag a little bit about your accomplishments. It's important to do that. I think that can be hard for people when they're first starting out, but it's all part of the fun. So anyway, that's it from me. Thanks.
Okay, and I will answer, does working in the foreign service have time flexibility, and is it difficult to manage having a family? The short answer is yes, there's time flexibility, and it is not difficult to manage having a family, or I would say not any more difficult than it is to managing a family, period. When overseas, you know, we have a community service liaison office that will help us if we need advice on care for young children or after school activities or weekend activities or weekend excursions. We also, while in the Foreign Service and working at a U.S. embassy overseas, we also enjoy all of the holidays that you enjoy here in the U.S. plus local holidays. So there's a lot of time that we get to spend with our family members, and there's a community of support that helps us get through some of the, you know, what am I going to do with my kid after school, or what kind of activity can I afford in this country? There are people to answer those questions for you. So you can have a family and enjoy your life in the Foreign Service too. And that's it.
Well, thank you all for your questions. There's many, many questions, and I were unable to get all of them. But I wanted to thank everybody for joining us today. And I'm not sure if Chris had something to say to close out, but we've really enjoyed this panel very much and all the questions. There are many, many more questions. I'm reading through them, and we can try to answer them to the best we can. But I wanted to thank my fellow panelists for joining me today, and for the organizer putting it together, and all of you who have joined us. I hope all of you got something out of this, obviously. But I think most importantly, there are many opportunities, and you should be open-minded for them, because I think, and I really appreciate what Allison was saying, you really do want to advocate for yourself. And that's one thing, it's incredibly important, and it is expected to do, and nobody else is gonna do it but you. So you might as well do it and understand how to do that in a good way. So thank you very much for everybody. If any of my panelists have any final words they would like to say, I'll certainly pass it over to them, but I just want to say thank you. Allison or Stephanie, please, over to you.
Just thanks to everybody and best of luck. I hope, wish you luck in your future careers.
Same here. I would like to wish everyone good luck. And I'm very happy to know that there are quite a number of you out there looking to engage in international affairs and to do hard things in your life. That's very nice to know. Best of luck.
Thank you, everyone. Have a great night.